talk she has titled Through Commerce for Community. Dr. Dávila is a professor of anthropology and a social and culture analysis at New York University and I believe American Studies. She's a cultural anthropologist interested in urban and ethnic studies, the political economy of culture and media, and consumption studies. Her work focuses on Puerto Ricans in the eastern United States and Latinos nationwide. Two of her most celebrated books are Latinos Inc., Marketing and the Making of the People, from the University of California Press from 2001, and Latinos Spin, Public Image and the Whitewashing of Race from the New York Press from 2008. Latinos Spin received last year, which means 2011, the Latin American Studies Association Prize for the Best Book in Latino Studies. I have to say that these two volumes were tremendously influential to the work that we've seen together. So please help me welcome Dr. Dávila.
Since the 1980s, so-called Hispanic art, when the art world first discovered the marketability of exhibiting Latino and American artists with a similar pan-Latino category, Latino artists have faced challenges to gain recognition of their own terms. Unrecognized by neither the Latin American nor the North American art canon, Latino artists have had few institutional structures to support them, a lack of professional critics and curators to translate and validate their work, and no institutionalized art market to promote and uplift it. Almost 30 years later, the number of curators, galleries, and collectors who are familiar with Latino art artists has grown considerable. But the field still lacks in recognition and infrastructure, while Latino institutions have become precariously vulnerable in the current economic downturn. To this, we must add dominant trends toward post-identity postures in the arts that parallel the liberal resignifications of race that undermine the role of ethnic-specific galleries and museums. Following up on the dominance of multiculturalism and identity politics throughout the 1980s and 90s, the new post-identity framework has presented unique challenges to how Latino artists and curators negotiate their place in the mainstream art world. Specifically, because identity frameworks are predicated on the dominant Western canon that art is more valuable, the most global, universalist, and is connected from particular communities, leading many artists and curators to do away with ethnic-specific categories of gatherers. This situation is especially hurtful to Latino artists who do not shed their identity so easily within mainstream artistic circles, while mainstream art spaces are rarely expanding to include their work, as evident by the recent weekly biennial and the debate over its exclusion of minority artists. In what follows, I want to examine the work of Miguel Luciano, a Puerto Rican New York-based artist whose works and trajectory speaks to some of the larger issues that frame the work of many Latino artists in New York and New York. And particularly, this very much in conversation with Juan Sanchez, with the one who told you, and one of the things that struck me when I saw the Yes is the kind of very similar themes that will serve as a model to work. In particular, Miguel's work is landed with references to and commentaries on the commodification of international culture, the politics of space, the ascendancy of neoliberal, market logics and values, all of which speak to important themes in Miguel's exhibition. Miguel's work is additionally interesting because it has gained international recognition while the artist has maintained a big commitment in his political identity and a few references to the Bolivian and Latino communities in New York and elsewhere. And this is true also of one science and the compost portfolio. This adds to my interest in this work as an artist who has been able to validate and anchor the value of communities to work that is both assertive of identities and that systematically questions the preeminence of neoliberal logics that is about matters of community and identity. What struck me first about Luciano's work is the same that stroke is the same quality that you see in his gallery, is the playful, accessible, yet critical way in which the artist explores difficult themes through difficult themes in Luciano's case, particularly through corporate communication and co-optation of Puerto Rican and Latino culture. Luciano's paintings draw from some of the most well-known characters, and we can show some of them, characters of consuming culture, such as the cracker jack sailor that you saw earlier, Ronald McDonald's, among other signs representing the fast food chains and commercial brands that connect late Latino neighborhoods, supermarkets, and bodegas, and Latino bodies with high rates of obesity and diabetes. Yet Luciano is not only concerned with exploring the perils of the seemingly innocent characters. Instead, he works through them, using their familiarity with consumers to draw in viewers to scenes representing the disheartening legal realities of colonialism, imperialism, and genocide and political struggle. Thus, in the Clapper One painting we saw earlier, you see taglines that include, quote, highest combat fatalities in the United States, or paramount quoted Puerto Ricans for kings, or citizenship priorities, all stand to the marketing matters of the Clapper Jackbox. Additionally, Luciano's work exposes the fantasy and disenchantment of consumer culture while reevaluating elements of popular culture and history that are regularly disregarded as insignificant according to dominant analytic frameworks. Luciano's installations are open for the legal folkloric icons, from the street vending carts, and we can go back to the carts and the sculpture, to the artwork, from the vending carts used by informal workers, and from the hunger all of which have been partially associated with popular classes, but also popular related to iconic symbols of Puerto Rican resiliency, affirmation, and pride. In Luciano's hands, these popular symbols are further revamped, embellished, and turned into precious objects that are inherently valuable, not only because they become memorialized as art, but because of the superior craftsmanship and quality materials with which they are made or embedded. In pure plantain, that you see here, the plantain is submerged in platinum, the most precious of metals, while in thin maipiragua, the vending cart is turned into a shiny, bright orange fiberglass bicart that is hyper-modified with a modern speaker and media system. And that's the the contrast, and this is the old sculpture, the painting by the other one. The contrast established between the mundane objects of popular culture and the larger than life crisis they take serves as a poignant commentary of the evaluation of culture, not unlike the blending of high and low art forms was used as part of the aesthetic strategy and visual language of the Chicano and American art movements, and continues to be used by many Latino artists precious and mundane. It is worth noting that when Chicano art and artists who have been subject to a small but growing scholarly literature, there's almost no documentation of the notable contribution of American and Puerto Rican artists. There are many reasons for this void, not least of which is Puerto Rican's historical marginalization in New York City and the island's colonial status that has hindered Puerto Rican's easy placement in the Latin American and the American artistic canon. These are the same reasons that led to the formation of Puerto Rican specific and art cultural institutions in the cities and cities that have not changed. Additionally, the Puerto Rican artistic community in the United States is small and fragmented. Many Puerto Rican artists come to the States primarily from middle class backgrounds to pursue MFAs and have different backgrounds and concerns than the U.S. world-born counterparts. Not only do many of these Puerto Rican artists don't know the legacies of the Puerto Rican pioneers, but through their MFA programs, they become professionalized into new conceptual and intellectual artistic trends that have greater international appeal. Many of them purposefully distance themselves from their Puerto Rican identity or embrace it only when strategically useful but developing a lukewarm connection to communities. And in the short car ride, Viviana and I had this very good conversation, right? Sharing and I saw the same kind of positioning in Viviana's work. This kind of rejection of kind of trends that are made professional and then the programs that kind of turn to more to work that is more engaging with communities that engage with installations that is interactive and live consumers too. Luciano is part of a small cadre who is working for the economies that are exploring the legacy of these enemies that is dismissed by dominant intellectual friends and that can arguably compromise mainstream artistic traditional analytical work. For these artists, a numerical tradition is not so much an aesthetic tradition or a geographically limited one, but rather a tradition of an artist whose work is connected to community, to activism, and to a socially and politically motivated work that addresses concerns of the Puerto Rican diaspora. It's about empowerment, the empowerment of an identity that is rooted both the aquí and the there. Luciano was making clear that what he was identifying with was not an aesthetic tradition that can be neatly represented or described by art historians, but with a strategically structurally informed position. Unfortunately, positions like this face challenges on the world of art world critics who celebrate post-identity and post-political positions. And this is evidence, particularly by the New York art critic Colin Potter, whenever he reviews Latino exhibits. He pulls any kind of identity, In fact, Luciano's Latino campaign was dismissed as identity trapped when it was showed at the Brooklyn's first Caribbean art show, even when it was one of the most commented pieces in the exhibition world. The point is that curators have always known where or how to exhibit work like Luciano's that engages in critical identity issues. So what we see is that identity conceptual currents come and go in some of the critical issues raised by Latino critics and scholars 30 years ago in relationship to the earliest exhibitions of Latino and Latin American art, art remain largely unchanged. Early on, when Patrick Ramirez exposed the limited conceptual frameworks guiding North American colonial practices, she pointed to the ascendancy of Euro-American modernism and its ability to engage with cultural and racial difference, such as the notion that aesthetics can be separated from social political contexts, and the early penchant for surrealism or folkloric authenticity as the only repertoire to represent it by the Latin American art. Moreover, as Karen Dávila's notes about Chicano art, the scholarship has not kept apace with the growth of Latino artists, because most art history programs remain in forest and whitewash. Students are often encouraged to pursue or recognize artists or movements in Latin American or European art history rather than Dávila chose to note that research on Chicano art, and also by extension the few studies of Puerto Rican art, still fall prey to dominant art historical frameworks that reduce artistic production to temporalities, such as before and after the Chicano movement, or else to integrating Latino artists within Euro-American movements and established styles. These narrow conceptions not only tend to homogenize what is in fact largely undocumented cultural production, but the emphasis on breaks with the Chicano movement or the Puerto Rican movement tends to oversee important continuities. Just as problematic, integrating Latino artists into mainstream movements fails to relate these artists back to the cultures of origins or to the ethnic-specific movements, institutions, and communities that mentor and help build their artistic trajectories. And that also serves Juan Sánchez and Miguel Luciano having the first shows and the main in places like the Memoria and the Dávila. And Miguel Luciano's first person show was curated by Juan Sánchez. So you see the continuity, how these artists are actually validated by the same institutions that they're being forced to distance themselves from once they gain significant notoriety. The fact is that the political climate at play in exhibition settings may at times seem more or less only transposing types of arts or artists in its sometimes mentioned the discovery of culturalism, identity, or gender. However, these realities and identities are not rhetorical discoveries of the art world, but very real and visible, based on the art, the history, and social conditions, not to mention of people's racialized and gender bodies. In some, these categorizations and historical positions don't simply come and go based on whether critics and curators summon or afford them. Instead, they can only dissipate even when art world becomes more colored and diverse. In some Latino artists, an art criticism reminds us that diversity is not sufficiently conceived in relationship to the incorporation and representation of ethnic and racial colors within the art establishment. But through the inclusion of more expansive definitions for evaluation that account for alternative practices produced outside of dominant territorial trends. In other words, legitimacy should never be reduced to making it in the narrow world of the commercial gallery circuit. We don't account for the artists who maintain or are fed or inspired by connections and through records of the communities. The evaluation of Latino art will remain incomplete and largely unaddressed. Writing about the Latino art pioneers, Jasmine Ramirez documents how their work was not only about local empowerment, but about challenging Eurocentric constructions of identity, as well as of art and value itself. As she notes, the alternative institutions that Puerto Rican and American artists found in the 60s and 70s social civil rights struggles of the times aim to reevaluate the most basic elements of Puerto Rican cultural history and language from the standpoint of Eurocentric positions. Whether it was indigenous Taino symbolism, the African legacy of Spanish English code switching, or Spanglish, these and other elements were posited as resources for cultural production in ways that validated the power and resilience of communities through work that refused to be seen through Eurocentric eyes, but as part of larger political initiatives that were educative and formative of alternative imaginaries for Puerto Ricans and other marginalized communities. In other words, these were not simple artists, but rather they were activists, in William and Wilson Valentine's perceptive term. This ethos and position for cultural production is as essential today as it was when the Puerto Rican body first elaborated it. In fact, given the current political climate that we've seen, the attack on the studies, the presence of the religious of immigration and Latino, and the relevant amnesia around issues of Latino historical continuity, this position is actually more present than ever today. It's in this context that the work of artists like Miguel and Viviana, and some of the artists we've seen before, appear as such daring and significant rejoinder. In particular, I find that this work becomes a critical response to the kind of dominant political and historical position. It's a way in which these artists are basically laughing out loud at this position and exposing its premises and the fallacies of its premises out loud in a way that makes you sort of not entirely reject, but it seduces you and it makes you think. And most importantly, all along, it means that what was important, valuable, and transcendent, which is the value of communities. And and I forgot my page. There we go. The power of imagination, as I was saying, the art ultimately but on laughing at all those pretenses, is really evaluating and reinstating the power of the imagination and the resilience.